Headline. An imprint of Headline Publishing Group Limited presents Death to the Emperor by Simon Scarrow. Read by Jonathan Keeble. Prologue. Britannia, November AD 60. The king died shortly before dawn. Outside the royal round hut, his retainers sat quietly around a large fire. At another time, they would have been drinking and talking loudly in good cheer, interrupted by bursts of song amid the revelry. But this last night, they had sat in a somber mood, their muted conversation confined to brief exchanges about the future of the kingdom after Prasutagus had passed from this world. It was known that he had recently changed his will and named the Roman Emperor Nero as his co-heir, alongside his queen. The news of this had struck many of his people as an act of betrayal. By what right had Prasutagus gifted half the Iceni kingdom to a despot who lived in a city far away beyond the sea? Moreover, Nero was the ruler of an empire whose legions had put down a minor uprising and killed many of the tribe's warriors only a few years earlier, when Scapula had been governor. Roman soldiers had looted villages and abused the women. Roman veterans, based at the colony founded at Camalodunum, had seized the lands of farmers and the estates of nobles bordering the territory claimed by the colony. All of this was a cause of great shame to the proud people of the Iceni. Now they did what they could to assuage the burden of humiliation by refusing to trade with Roman merchants and rebuffing any contact with the invaders as far as possible. As much as the king's advisers had shared the feelings of the people with respect to the will, they had come to accept, as had Prasutagus, that an accommodation was needed with Rome if the tribe was to have any control over its destiny. The critical issue was the treaty that had followed the invasion some 17 years ago. In exchange for accepting Roman protection and recognition of his rule of the tribe, the king had agreed that Rome would have the right to crown his successor. At the time, he had been assured that it was a mere formality, but he and his advisers had come to learn that the status of client king, as the Romans referred to it, was little more than a precursor to the annexation of the kingdom, after which Rome would rule directly. The king and his council had hoped that naming Nero as his co-heir would placate the appetite of Rome, and at the same time be taken as a token of Iceni loyalty to the empire. Some had warned that this was a false hope, and pointed to the example of other tribes who had come to regret treating with Rome. The matter was made more worrying by the notification Prasutagus had received from the governor in Londinium that the silver gifted to the king at the time the agreement was made was not in fact a gift, but a loan. Rome intended to foreclose with interest the moment Prasutagus died. Much of the coin had been used to buy grain to feed the people after the crops had failed these last 2 years, and little remained to repay to Rome's moneylenders. The knowledge of all this weighed heavily on the minds of those gathered around the bier in the royal hall, upon which the king's body lay. He had been too weak to rise from his sickbed these last 10 days, and his wife and queen, Boudica, had hardly left his side as she nursed him as best she could. It had been a pitiful time. In his prime, Prasutagus had been as tall and powerfully built a warrior as there had ever been in the Iceni tribe. His flowing straw-coloured hair had framed a broad, good-humoured face, and his clear blue eyes had twinkled, adding to the sense that here was a man who enjoyed life and easily communicated such a sentiment to those fortunate to share his company. He had been loved by most of his people, and those who might not have loved him respected him. The illness of the last year had eaten away at him, so that now he was barely recognizable, even to those who knew him best. Little more than skin on bones, with sunken eyes and mottled skin, his features frequently twisting in agony at the pain racking his failing body. Boudica had exhausted every attempt to cure him, and the tribe's druids had proved powerless. Casting aside her distaste, she had even paid for a Roman medic from Londinium to come to the Iceni capital. He too had failed. In the end, all she could do was try to comfort her dying husband and make offerings to the gods to ensure that he was welcomed into the afterlife. She had sat through the night, listening to his shallow breathing, becoming more laboured, until it was little more than a faint, wheezing rattle. At last, it had stopped. She waited a moment before pressing her ear against his skeletal chest, but there was no heartbeat. With a sigh, she raised her head and kissed his limp hand tenderly, before laying it across his breast and turning to face her daughters, other family, nobles and members of the Royal Council. Drawing herself up, she announced, "King Prasutagus is dead." No one moved nor spoke. Then her younger daughter, Merida, closed her eyes, covered her face with her hands and began to sob. The older, 2 years senior to her sister, had inherited her father's strong features, and at 16 was already betrothed to a nobleman with a coastal estate. She approached her mother and embraced her. "Oh, my sweet Bardia," her mother whispered in her ear, "what is to become of us now? What is to become of the Iceni?" "The Iceni will endure, mother. We always have." Boudicca increased the pressure of her embrace, moved by her daughter's simple expression of conviction. "Yes, of course." If only she understood, she thought. Our tribe stands at the very edge of oblivion. Our fate is no longer ours alone to decide. Our future will be settled far away, in Rome. The kingdom of the Iceni would continue or fall on the whim of the boy Emperor Nero. She released her daughter and held her at arm's length, regarding with approval the firm set of her jaw and the taut determination not to give way to grief. The tears would come later, in private, as would her own. But there were other matters to deal with first. She indicated Merida and spoke softly.
"Tend to your sister. She was ever her father's favourite, as you are mine. Take her to your hut and comfort her." "Yes, mother. I'll be along once I have dealt with the Royal Council."
They exchanged a brief look, and Bardia nodded. They had discussed this moment and what must follow several days earlier, when the king had taken to his deathbed. Boudicca watched as her daughters left the hall, her heart aching with concern for what the future might bring for them. Nothing was certain anymore. All the tribe's traditions, reaching back across unnumbered generations, might be swept away in the days to come, if Rome acted with callous disregard for the people of the Iceni. What would become of Bardia and Merida in a world that no longer had a place for princesses? Who would protect them when the royal household had been stripped away? As they disappeared through the entrance to the hall, Boudicca nodded to the commander of the king's bodyguard, and he quietly ordered the two warriors on duty to close the doors. The soft thud of timbers caused some to glance over their shoulder before they fixed their attention on their queen. She was solidly built, with broad hips and shoulders, and her height gave her a physical presence that was matched by her commanding personality. Although in her middle years, with a slightly creased face, her gaze was shrewd and penetrating. The long red hair, tied back with a simple leather band, made her stand out from the other women of the court. A keen intelligence, combined with the learning she had acquired in childhood, thanks to the tutor her noble father had brought back from Gaul, meant that Boudicca was one of only a handful of her people who could speak and write Latin. As such, she had been the right arm of Prasutagus throughout his reign, and as his health began to fail, she had assumed his authority to ensure that the Iceni were ruled wisely and for the most part fairly. She had won the trust of the people and the majority of the royal court. But now that the king was dead, there would be some who aspired to take his place. Boudicca knew who they were and why most of them should not be trusted with power, particularly at such a delicate time. A headstrong noble boldly asserting the ambitions of the Iceni might anger Rome and bring down her wrath on the tribe. The ease with which Roman soldiers had put down the uprising a few years earlier had been a salutary lesson for the Iceni. The defeat had been made more humbling by Rome's insistence that the tribe's warriors surrender their arms. The only permitted weapons were to be used for hunting, and the armor and swords, passed down from father to son and treated with reverence, had been handed to the Romans. Not all, of course. Caches had been hidden, buried beneath their huts or secreted amid the treacherous waterways and marshes that the Romans were loath to enter. There was a feeling in the tribe that a day would come when the swords of the Iceni warriors would be drawn again. That day was not now, Boudicca resolved. She studied the faces of the nobles, warriors, and members of the king's council, marking the mix of respect, calculation, and expectation in their expressions. Then she looked back at the body of her husband, the man she had soon come to love after their arranged marriage. She already felt a keen ache of longing for him, and smiled sadly as she recalled his hearty laughter and the affection that was always present in their private life, away from their roles as rulers of the Iceni. She closed her eyes and drew a deep breath, pushing aside thoughts of the past and forcing her mind to focus as she turned to the others in the hall.
We have lost our king. The question before us is to decide who should succeed him. Although I am your queen, it is our custom that the king's council and the nobles have the ultimate right to choose our next ruler. I will say it now, before all gathered here, that I would be honored to rule in the stead of Prosuticus. You know my worth. I have proved it this last year, as our beloved king was stricken by the illness that has finally taken him. It was also his express wish that I inherit the kingdom.
Alongside the Roman emperor, a voice interrupted. Her gaze swung towards a stout noble to the right of those gathered before her. He wore a gold torque around his neck, fashioned to look like a two-headed snake. The breadth of his chest and shoulders made up for his lack of height, and a fringe of fair hair ringed his bald head. A plaited moustache drooped either side of his thin lips, which now lifted slightly in a sneer.
My cousin, Sifidobnus, you know the reasons why Nero was named. You were in the council when the will was agreed.
I didn't agree, if you recall. And I wasn't the only one. Sifidobnus glanced round at the other nobles, and several nodded and muttered their support.
Nevertheless, Boudicca continued, the king asked the council to vote on the matter, and the result was clear, and we are bound by the decision.
Who says so? No oath was sworn before a druid. I say we are not bound to abide by the terms of the will. Prosuticus is no more. Maybe his successor will choose to renounce the agreement. Maybe the new king will have the courage to stand up to Rome and salvage the honour of the Iceni.
Boudicca felt her guts twist with anger and disgust. Her husband's body was still warm, and yet this long-standing rival was already intimating that Prosuticus had been a coward and betrayed his people. Clenching her jaw to prevent herself from expressing her outrage at this disrespect, she stood still, aloof and silent, glaring at Sifidobnus for a few heartbeats before she responded.
It's clear that you think yourself worthy of taking the place of my husband. Is that it?
Sifidobnus smiled before assuming a more imperious expression.
If it is the choice of our people that I should rule, then that is a decision I would honour with my life. If I were to become king, it would be my sworn duty to restore the prestige of the Iceni and keep the kingdom out of the clutches of Rome.
Several men voiced their support for this ambition, and Boudicca's quick glance identified them as his cronies, nobles and leading warriors who had followed him in the failed uprising of a few years earlier. They had made great play of what they called their heroic struggle with Rome. In truth, it had been a conflict doomed from the start. Too few had rallied to the standard of Sifidobnus when he had appealed to his people. Rather than waiting to put the matter before Prosuticus and his court and let the Iceni decide as a whole, the noble and his faction had marched against the invader. It had been a rash move. Boudicca raised a hand to command silence, and only lowered it when the last of Sifidobnus's followers had fallen quiet.
You speak of the prestige of the Iceni. Yet it was you who brought shame upon our people by the ease with which you were defeated. You were not even brought low by the Roman legions, All it took to crush your force was a handful of their auxiliary cohorts, backed up by levies from the other tribes of Britannia. Second-rate soldiers at best, she added scornfully.
At least we fought, Sifa Dubna shot back.
Fought and won honour for our people.
Honour?
Boudicca laughed bitterly.
What did you achieve? You raided a few farms, burned a handful of villas and massacred a few patrols. Then, the moment the Romans gathered enough troops to counter the threat, you bolted to the safety of a fort in the marshes. How long did you and your brave warriors hold out? Do remind us all.
Sifa Dubnus glared at her, his face draining of colour.
Nothing to say for yourself, Boudicca prompted. Then let me say it for you. You lasted precisely 2 days while the Roman commander waited for you to respond to his offer to surrender. And then, when you didn't, he ordered his men forward and it was all over in a moment. You and your warriors threw down your swords the moment the gate was smashed in. It was fortunate that so few were killed and that the Roman governor chose to be lenient, but it still cost us most of our weapons and armor, as well as compensation for the damage caused to Roman property and the conscription of 200 of our best young men into the Roman auxiliary units. To add to our injury, the Romans now have a string of outposts guarding our frontier.
She paused to let her words sink in.
And you have the gall to call that winning honour for our people? Pah!
If the tribe had followed us, we would have triumphed, Sifa Dubnus retorted. If Prosuticus had mustered the Iceni warriors, we would have crushed the Roman auxiliaries.
But you never gave him the chance, she replied. It was over before there was time for the king to summon the tribal council. In any case, even if we had overcome the auxiliaries, we'd then have had to face the legions.
She looked at some of the older men standing before her.
Only a few of us have seen the legions in action. Those of us who have know that it would be foolhardy for the Iceni to wage war on them. The legions would crush us, as they have every tribe that has opposed them in battle. Even the great warlord Caraticus could not defeat them and was hunted down, captured, and taken to Rome in chains. You, Sifa Dubnus, are not old enough to have seen this.
Perhaps age makes cowards of those who fear Rome, he sneered. Perhaps it is time for younger men to wield the swords of the Iceni. If I am chosen to succeed, Prosuticus, I swear I will give Rome something to fear. We will inspire the other tribes to rise up and cast out the invader. And when that is done, we will be the most powerful tribe in the land.
Bold words from one who faltered at the first step, Boudicca scoffed. Do you think my husband did not harbour the same dreams as you do? Yet he had the good sense to know what could be achieved and what was impossible. Yes, there may come a day when the other tribes grow weary of living under the Roman yoke and rise against the invader, but that day is still distant. Until then, we must hide our anger. We must keep our blades sharp but hidden. We must make Rome think that the Iceni are loyal enough to be safely left alone to govern our own affairs and pay the tribute that is due. If we rise before we are ready, before the other tribes find common cause, we are doomed to defeat. And next time, Rome will not be so lenient. They will butcher our warriors, burn our farms and seize our treasure, and those who survive will be sold into slavery. In time, the very name of our tribe will be obliterated, and no one will remember that we ever existed. Is that what you wish for?
Boudicca opened her arms as she appealed to the men before her, then fixed her attention on Sifa Dubnus.
Is that what you desire? Do you wish to lead our brave young warriors to death and destruction?
She saw the first glimmer of doubt in his expression, and then just as quickly the return of the defiant and arrogant posture, and she realized that she had failed to persuade him. He was still too young for that measure of experience that permitted wisdom. Very well, she decided. He must be prevented from becoming the successor to Prosuticus.
The will of my husband is clear, and has been affirmed by the tribal council. I am your queen. Your loyalty is mine by right.
But you are a woman,
Sifa Dubnus protested. A tribe such as the Iceni should be ruled by a warrior. And who is to say that a woman cannot be a warrior? I have fought at my husband's side. I have wielded sword and spear and shed the blood of my enemies. My own blood has been spilled in combat. Can you say as much, young man? You are an unblooded warrior, thanks to your swift surrender.
Sifadubnus grimaced and emitted an audible snarl as she continued.
I have proven myself in battle, and so the Iceni is ruled by a warrior, just as you say it should be.
We shall see. It is my right to put the matter before the council and let them debate whether the will is legitimate or not.
And you are free to do so when the council next meets.
But that is months away. Why wait? We could decide here and now. The council is gathered. There's no need to delay.
The council is here to witness the passing of our king, to honour his memory and pay their respects to a warrior whose renown you will never match, Sifadubnus. We will grieve and bury him, and then I will rule the Iceni until such time as the council decides that another should take my place, and that they cannot do until the winter gathering, according to our custom. Is that not so, my lords?
She looked directly at one of Prosuticus's oldest and most respected advisers, the druid Bladocus, who nodded and filled his lungs before speaking clearly.
It is true. Until then, I swear by all the gods that I will be loyal to Queen Boudica.
That is my oath.
And mine,
cried another man. More took up the cry, drowning out the few voices that raised a protest. Sifadubnus saw that he was outnumbered, and his youthful features creased into a bitter frown. As the cries died away, Boudica turned to him.
The Iceni have spoken. You have no choice but to accept.
For now.
But you do accept, Boudica pressed him.
Yes, he hissed.
Then say it. Speak the oath of loyalty to your queen.
Sifadubnus folded his arms and looked pained for a moment, before announcing in a flat tone, I swear by all the gods of our tribe to be loyal to the queen.
Then it is done,
Boudica concluded.
Now we must tell the people that Prosuticus is no more, and that I will rule in his place.
She gestured to the two warriors guarding the entrance to the hall, and they opened the doors and took up position on either side as the members of the royal council and nobles turned to file outside into the large open space bounded by a palisade. The crowd that had gathered around the open fires rose to their feet expectantly. The first glimmer of dawn was stealing up from the eastern horizon as a light drizzle began, beading the cloaks, tunics, and hair of the tribespeople. Boudica was the last to leave. She looked down on her husband one final time and whispered,
My love, I fear you go to a peace I shall not know while I live.
Then she drew the woven cover over his face and turned towards the doors. Despite the significance of the moment, she was already looking ahead. While she had thwarted Sifadubnus's ambitions for now, there could be no doubt that he would plot against her in the months to come, despite his oath. He was too dangerous a man to be entrusted with the fate of the Iceni. Yet he was cunning enough to play on the tribe's desire to restore the golden age described in song and legend. Boudica knew that her people, like most Celts, preferred to wallow in sentimentality rather than deal with hard and unpleasant truths. Make no mistake, she thought. Sifadubnus is the enemy within. He would have to be watched closely. Then there was the matter of the enemy without. Despite the treaty between the Iceni and Rome, there had always been tension, and she could sense that it was coming to a head. Her fate, the fate of her family, and the fate of the Iceni depended on how Rome responded to the news of Prosuticus's death. She could not shake off her foreboding about the future. At best, the Romans would use the situation to increase their influence over the Iceni. At worst, they would resolve to annex the tribe and reduce it to a region of the new province they had carved out on the island. As she emerged from the hall and stepped up onto the bed of her husband's chariot,
Bladicus called out to the throng,
"The king is dead! Behold Boudica, queen of the Iceni! May our gods preserve her and bring her prosperity in peace and victory and spoils in war!"
War. May the gods spare us from that, Boudica silently prayed with all her heart. She gazed into the mid-distance as the crowd called out her name again and again, and the drizzle gave way to rain, borne on a chill wind, blowing in with the dawn. Chapter 1. Camelodunum.
Keep the bloody point up!
Centurion Macro growled, as he parried aside another weak blow from his opponent and delivered a sharp tap on the shoulder as a rebuke for the youngster's poor effort.
How can you possibly become a legionary if you fight like that? Shit, I've seen newborn kittens who look more threatening. Try again. This time, strike at me like you mean it.
He took a pace back and lowered himself into a crouch, weight instinctively balanced so that he was poised to spring forward or aside instantly, the result of over 30 years of soldiering. Raising his wooden training sword, he inscribed small circles with the blunted tip.
"Now, Lucius," he instructed, "get it right this time."
Opposite him, a thin boy, some 8 years of age, with a mop of unruly dark curls, gritted his teeth and adopted a similar stance as he readied himself to attack. His dark eyes narrowed, and he glared back at Macro. They stood on the gravel to one side of the small tiled pond in the courtyard of Macro's house. Two women and another man were watching from the chairs arranged around a wooden table at the end of the garden. At the man's feet curled a huge dog with wiry hair, its long head stretched out between its front paws. They were warmed by the logs burning in an iron-framed basket set before them, and yet they still needed cloaks. Like most of the Romans who had come to settle in the new province of Britannia, they were not used to the clammy cold of the island's winters. Macro and Lucius, by contrast, wore only simple tunics and had worked up a sweat as they exercised in the courtyard.
"Give it to him, Lucius!"
one of the women called out cheerfully. She was a firmly built woman with a kindly round face, brown eyes and dark hair. Macro frowned at her.
"Thanks for the loyal support, wife."
Petronella laughed and flapped a hand dismissively. He was about to respond when the boy let out a shrill cry and charged at him, thrusting at his midriff. The centurion parried the blow easily and made a riposte, aiming at the centre of the lad's chest. Back swept the smaller training sword and rapped against Macro's weapon as Lucius rushed in to strike at his opponent's stomach. Despite his heavier frame, Macro moved fluidly out of the way, and the point of the boy's sword cut through the air at his side. He was about to slap the boy on the shoulder again when Lucius brought his heel down on the exposed toes of Macro's leading foot.
"Ow!"
the centurion cried out in surprise, as much as pain, and hobbled back a step.
"Why, you cunning little bastard!"
"Mind your language!"
his wife shouted. Before Macro could respond, Lucius had darted back a pace and lunged at the centurion's chest. The point landed squarely just beneath his ribcage, a sharp prod that merely injured his pride for a heartbeat before he grinned and lowered his sword.
"That's it? Well done, Lucius."
The youngster's ferocious expression relaxed into a look of proud delight, and he turned to the bearded man seated at the table. In his mid-30s, the latter was slender and had the same dark curls as his son. His face bore a vivid diagonal scar from brow to cheek, but it did not mar his sensitive good looks. He returned the smile, and then his mouth opened to give a warning, but he was too late. Macro slapped Lucius on the wrist with the flat of his training sword, just hard enough to cause the boy to drop his own weapon. He yelped and scowled at the centurion.
"Never turn your back on your opponent while he's still on his feet," Macro admonished him. "How many times have I told you that, eh?"
There was a serious tone to his voice, and Lucius lowered his head as he rubbed his wrist and muttered,
"That hurt."
"That's just nothing compared to the hurt you'll feel from the sword that'll be stuck through your spine if you ever do that in a real battle."
Lucius pressed his lips together, then his chin trembled in wounded pride. Macro saw that he was on the verge of tears and did not want to let the boy embarrass himself. He ruffled his hair affectionately and spoke softly.
"No harm done, lad.
No shame in making mistakes when you're only just learning how to use a sword. I was the same when I started out.
He glanced towards the table and grinned.
Your father was one of the most hopeless recruits ever to join the Second Legion. More of a danger to himself and his comrades than the fiercest German warrior that ever breathed. Ain't that the truth, Cato?
Cato grimaced. If you say so, my friend.
And look how he turned out,
Macro continued as he placed a hand on Lucius's shoulder.
Risen through the ranks from Optio to Prefect, and on the way he served as a tribune of the Praetorian Guard, and picked up more awards for bravery than most soldiers do in a lifetime. One of the finest officers in the army, without a doubt. So you keep practicing, young Lucius, and one day you may achieve as much as your father has, eh?
The fair-haired woman beside Cato looked at him warmly, then reached over and planted a soft kiss on his scarred cheek.
My hero.
Enough of that, Claudia. Cato recoiled with a frown. It was not in his nature to take praise easily. Just do your best, son. No one can ask more of you than that. The boy came to the table and squatted beside the dog to stroke it. The animal wagged its tail happily, then suddenly lifted its head and licked his face.
Don Cassius, stop!
The boy laughed as he rose and sat on one of the spare stools, his feet not quite reaching the ground. He looked up at Cato.
If you're a good soldier, father, then what are we doing here in Camelodunum? Surely you should be on the frontier, fighting the barbarians and the druids for the emperor.
There was an exchange of glances amongst the adults. The truth was that Claudia had been Nero's mistress before being sent into exile on Sardinia. She had since left the island to be with Cato, and they had been forced to come to the furthest corner of the empire to keep her safe. The veterans' colony of Camelodunum was a quiet backwater, where the chances of her being recognised and reported were small. But not small enough that they could risk letting Lucius inadvertently reveal the true reason behind their presence there.
Your father is resting between campaigns, said Petronella. He needs to be ready for when the Emperor next needs him. Besides, he wants to spend more time with you. You like it here, don't you, Lucius?
The boy thought a moment. There were other children at the colony his own age to play with, and in the summer there was fishing on the river and hunting in the woods that surrounded Macro's farm, half a day's journey away. He nodded.
I suppose so. But it's getting cold again.
Macro sighed.
Aye, too true. The bloody winter in this province was made by the gods to test us. Cold, damp and clammy. The roads turn to thick mud that'll suck your boots off, and we're stuck with eating salted meat and whatever fresh vegetables we can store.
Keep going, Petronella said archly. You're doing a fine job of cheering the lad up.
Cato reached for his cup of warmed wine and took a sip.
Oh, come on, Macro. It's not so bad. You've done well enough out of it.
He gestured to the house around the courtyard. It had once been the legate's quarters when a legionary fortress had been under construction. The work had been abandoned when the decision had been taken to establish the colony on the site instead. There were still many former military buildings in the settlement, although much of the rampart had been demolished and the defensive ditch filled in. Amid the existing buildings there was much new construction, including a forum, a theatre, an arena, and an imposing temple complex dedicated to the imperial cult.
You have the finest place in the colony, Macro. You've also a profitable farm in the country, and you're the senior magistrate of the colony's senate. To cap it all, you enjoy the greatest of fortune in having Petronella for a wife.
Cato raised his cup to her and bowed his head gently.
I'd say you were sitting pretty. A fine end to your military career, my friend.
You've earned it. You can live out your retirement in peace and in comfort. Petronella smiled, then took her husband's brawny arm and hugged it.
I suppose so,
Macro said.
Though I can't help missing the old life some days.
You're bound to. But you couldn't serve in the army forever.
Oh, no,
Macro said sadly. There was a pause before Claudia cleared her throat.
It is peaceful here, but it might be wise not to take it all for granted.
Cato turned to his son.
Why don't you go and see if your friends want to play?
The boy's gaze shifted to the wooden training swords lying on the table.
Can I take those with me?
As long as you're careful, said Cato. I don't want to hear about any broken bones or bloodied noses, understand? And take Parvus with you. Before Cato could change his mind, Lucius snatched the swords and trotted off towards the kitchen block at the rear of the house. He emerged a moment later with a lanky boy a few years older than himself. Parvus was a mute, whom Macro and Petronella had rescued from the wharves of Londinium the previous year and adopted into their household. The four adults stared after the boys as they ran back through the courtyard and disappeared into the corridor that led to the front of the house. Macro chuckled.
I dare say there'll be a few kids going home with bruises and grazes before the day's out.
Cato nodded and smiled faintly before turning to Claudia. I don't think it's wise to discuss certain things in front of Lucius. He's a good boy, but children have a way of repeating things they overhear.
I know. I'm sorry.
She folded her hands.
But you know as well as I do that the future of the province hangs in the balance. I heard Nero say it many times when I lived at the palace. He hates this island. It's a constant drain on the treasury, and he'd rather spend the silver on entertainments in Rome, keeping the mob happy. It's taking far longer than expected to subdue the tribes that haven't accepted Roman rule. Every year the legions and auxiliary cohorts need fresh recruits to replace the losses they've sustained.
She shrugged and shook her head.
Truly, I don't know how much longer he'll put up with it.
We'd be a fool to abandon Britannia,
Macro growled.
We've paid for this province with our blood. At least our soldiers have. If Nero throws all that aside, there'll be many here, in the ranks, as well as the colony, who'll be thinking it's time we had a new emperor. Besides, most of the work has been done. The lowland tribes present no threat. They've been conquered or disarmed and have signed treaties with Rome. The Brigantes in the north are under our thumb, and the only remaining hostiles are in the mountains to the west. And the new governor's made it clear that he's going to see to them. Ain't that right, Cato?
The younger man nodded. That's the news from our friend Apollonius in Londinium. Suetonius is concentrating men at Diva to strike into the mountains. It'll be tough going. Macro and I were part of the previous attempt. It didn't end well.
That's because the campaign started too late in the year,
Macro interrupted.
If it wasn't for the weather, we'd have done for those bastards in the hill tribes. We'd have taken Mona and put an end to the Druids too.
But we didn't, said Cato. And now that they have a victory over Rome under their belts, they're going to be even more difficult to subdue. If anyone can do it, Suetonius is the man. He has experience in mountain warfare. Did fine work in Mauritania a few years back. I imagine he was hand-picked for this job.
Or he pushed himself to the front of the queue,
Macro grinned.
One last chance to put the seal on his reputation. You know what these aristocrats are like. Anything to add lustre to the family name and outdo the deeds of their ancestors and their political rivals.
Will this Suetonius need to call up the reserves?
Petronella asked. Macro took her hand and squeezed it affectionately.
Not likely. There's too few of us here to make much of a difference, if we were recalled to the ranks. In any case, we're needed here. The governor knows the value of having a small force of veterans around to ensure that none of the local tribes are tempted to play while the cat's away.
Claudia gave a wry smile.
I thought you said the lowland tribes posed no threat.
So they don't,
Macro replied firmly.
The Trinovantes around Camelodunum are as meek as lambs.
I'm not surprised, she said. They've been harshly treated by the veterans at the colony, so I'm told. Their lands have been seized, and some of their men taken away and forced to serve in the auxiliary cohorts, while I've heard that many of the women have been violated.
There's always a little trouble early on,
Macro countered.
The lads of the colony are used to soldiering. It takes a few years before they get the hang of being civilians.
And in the meantime, the tribe's people just have to put up with it.
That's how it is, said Macro. We've conquered this place, just like we've conquered lands from here to the deserts of the east. Once they accept their lot, the tribes will be content with being part of the empire.
I wonder.
Claudia turned to Cato.
What do you think?
Cato paused to collect his thoughts. He wasn't as convinced as Macro about the security of this part of the new province. The year's harvest had been poor, and that wouldn't be taken into consideration when the tax collectors made their demands on the local people. Hunger and poverty caused discontent, and while the Trinovantes seemed docile enough, it was hard to imagine that the indignities and suffering they had endured at the hands of their newly imposed Roman masters would not cause bitter resentment, even if they were careful not to show it. If Governor Suetonius and his legions were campaigning across the far side of the province, it might tempt the hotheads amongst the local tribespeople to take advantage of the situation. Macro and the veterans at the colony were tough enough and able to put down any small-scale flare-ups, but a concerted uprising would present a real danger to the Roman inhabitants of Camulodunum. He considered a moment longer before he responded to Claudia's question. As long as there are legions in Britain, I doubt there will be any serious trouble in this area. The Iceni have had a taste of what defying Rome means. They'll not be anxious to repeat the experience. As for the Trinovantes, who knows? The bigger worry is what happens if Nero does decide to withdraw the legions. There are tens of thousands of Romans and other people from the Empire who have settled here. They'll be easy meat for any tribes that decide to attack them. The choice will be between staying and trying to defend what they hold, and abandoning their homes, their property, and their future here, and fleeing back across the sea to Gaul. Claudia turned to Macro and Petronella.
If Nero pulls the legions out, what will you two do?
Macro glanced at his wife, but she did not meet his eyes.
I don't want to give it all up. Everything we own here, and the half share in my mother's business in Londinium. I just don't know. I hope it never comes to that.
I'll drink to that, said Cato, keen to put his best friend at ease. It's hard to believe Nero will abandon Britannia. To give it up now would be a dangerous blow to Roman prestige. You can imagine how the mob would react to that, not to mention those senators who keep telling them how invincible Rome is.
See?
Macro nudged Petronella.
The lad's got a handle on how it is.
There's another reason why Nero will be reluctant to pull the legions out, Cato continued. If he withdraws them to Gaul, that will give the governor there a significant number of extra soldiers. Those who command powerful armies might be tempted to use them for political ends. So it's safer to keep those legions tied down here in Britannia. Macro tutted.
Oh, you have a devious mind, lad. A cynical mind.
I'm a realist, Cato shrugged. We've both been around long enough to know how the Empire works. You know I'm right. Macro reached for his cup.
All this talk about politics has made me thirsty.
He lifted the jug, but when he poured, only a thin trickle dribbled into his cup.
Shit. I'll have to get some more from the kitchen.
As he rose from his stool, Petronella cocked an ear towards the kitchen block at the far end of the courtyard.
What's all that about?
Macro frowned. Animated voices were coming from inside the building.
I'll better see to it.
He trudged off, jug in hand, and disappeared inside. The others continued to listen as the exchange grew in volume until it was suddenly cut off by the centurion demanding silence.
Sounds like trouble among the servants, Claudia commented.
Petronella shook her head.
They get on well. There's two Iceni girls, and the stable lad is a local. Never heard a crossword between them. We'll soon know what's up when Macro comes back.
As they waited, she changed the subject.
It'll be Saturnalia soon. Will you still be living in Camulodunum then? You're welcome to join us.
We'll be here for a while yet, Cato answered. He had rented a modest villa at the colony. It overlooked the river and was south-facing to take advantage of what sun the province provided. There he and Claudia lived quietly while raising Lucius. The boy's education was provided for by a man claiming to be a Greek scholar who had crossed from Gaul to set up a small school. His accent was not one that Cato had ever heard a Greek in tone, but he was competent, and Lucius was learning to read and write and the basics of figure work. A more refined education awaited him in Rome, once Cato deemed it safe to return to the capital. If any hint that Claudia had been traced to Britannia reached Londinium, it had been arranged that Apollonius would send them a warning. The Greek freedman had once served as a spy for Rome before he encountered Cato, and the two men regarded each other with respect, if not friendship. Macro had disliked him from the first and treated him with suspicion, but Apollonius had won Cato's trust and had now found himself a useful post at the governor's palace at Londinium. "It's a peaceful backwater," Cato continued, "and that suits us."
"We'd be delighted to share Saturnalia with you," Claudius smiled. "You must tell me what we can contribute to the occasion."
The sound of footsteps across the gravel interrupted the exchange, and they turned towards Macro. The centurion wore a concerned expression, and there was no freshly filled wine jug in his hands. "What's happened?" asked Cato.
"Bad news, I'm afraid."
Macro resumed his seat.
"Morgatha's just returned from the market. She encountered a Nicene fur trader who's come from the tribal capital. Prosuticus is dead."
Cato shook his head sadly. Both he and Macro had known the Iceni king well. They had fought alongside him shortly after the invasion, when the tribe was a firm ally of Rome. His queen Boudica was also counted a close friend. The last time they had met, less than a year ago, Prosuticus had looked sickly, a distant shadow of the powerful warrior he had been in his prime.
"There's more," said Macro. "It seems he named Boudica and Nero as co-heirs in his will. I doubt that's going to end well for the Iceni."
"Why's that?"
asked Claudia.
"Nero doesn't strike me as the kind who will settle for half of something when he can have all of it."
"Then surely this is a good thing for the province. It will give Nero a stronger stake in Britannia. More reason for him not to pull the legions out."
"Or he'll just decide to loot the Iceni kingdom for all it's worth and then abandon the island."
Claudia turned to Cato.
"What do you think?"
"I'm not sure how this will play out," said Cato. "It'll take time for word of the king's death to reach Rome, then for Nero to reflect on what course of action to take and send the response to the governor in Londinium. If the weather is kind, Suetonius will receive his instructions early next year, about the same time as the renewal of the oaths. The Iceni contingent will be there along with the other tribes and representatives of the Roman settlements to swear their loyalty to the emperor and Rome. That's when they'll find out what Nero has decided."
"And what do you think he will decide?" Claudia pressed him.
"I suspect Macro's right. The emperor will want it all, whatever Prosuticus's will says. If that happens, there'll be trouble. We know the Iceni." He nodded towards Macro. "They're a proud lot, with a strong sense of tradition. Fine warriors. We were lucky that they sided with us at the start, and lucky that it was only a handful of them who rose against us when Scapula was governor. If Nero plays this badly, he may provoke them into open rebellion. They'll fight like lions to protect their lands, and I fear it will be a bloodbath." Chapter 2 They had been tracking their prey all morning, and the noon sun hung low in the grey sky as flurries of snow blotted out the horizon. A short distance ahead of Macro and Cato was a Trinovantian hunter on foot, wearing a fur cape over his brown tunic and leggings. Cato was holding the bridle of his mount as they waited for him to inspect the ground. The hunter paused some 30 paces away and crouched as he examined a gap in the entanglement of gorse bushes that spread out on either side. There were many animal tracks in the snow fanning out from the gap, and it was hard to pick them apart and identify what creature might have made them.
"We may have lost him," Macro muttered,
as he rested the thick shaft of the boar spear against the horns of his saddle and reached for his canteen. He took out the stopper, tilted his head and took a swig before offering it to Cato. The prefect's eyes were on the hunter, watching as the man scrutinized the disturbed snow. He took a sip and handed the canteen back before shifting his spear to his spare hand.
"I don't know. Pernicatus seems to be onto something."
The hunter was tracing his fingers over the snow and then over the dark stem of the gorse bush to his right before he touched the surface delicately and then stared at his fingertip. He turned towards his Roman companions as he held up his hand so they could see the red smear.
"Blood. The boar came through here,"
he announced in guttural Latin. Pernicatus had hired himself out to Roman hunters ever since the colony was founded,
and had picked up the invader's language well enough to speak it fluently. He was held in high regard amongst the veterans for his skills as a tracker, and when they closed in for the kill, his adeptness with spear and bow was as good as that of any bestiarius in the Empire. The three-man hunting party had encountered the boar an hour or so after dawn, and there had been barely a chance to ready their spears before the beast charged through them and bolted. Cato had been lucky to land a glancing blow that had torn through its shoulder, not enough to cripple it, but enough to make it bleed and leave a trail to follow across the countryside. The blood spots had become less frequent as the wound had begun to clot, and they'd almost given up when they'd seen a handful of small splats in the snow close to the path leading to the gorse thicket. Cato was angry and frustrated with himself. It was the sign of a poor hunter to wound a creature and let it escape to suffer. He owed it to the animal to finish the job. Macro indicated the thicket ahead of them.
"Well, if the bastard's in there, we can't get close to him."
Cato looked round. The gorse extended 50 paces on either side and looked to be as much across, beyond which rose the boughs of a copse of pine trees. The track through the dense mass was narrow. Reluctantly, he agreed with his friend. There was no way they could ride through the thicket, and if they went on foot, they were bound to snag their cloaks and get caught up. If the boar charged them at that moment, there would be no chance to evade it. Still, there was one last trick they could attempt to provoke it. "Pernicatus, you stay here while the Centurion and I ride round and see if we can find where the track comes out on the other side. If we locate it, I'll call out to you. Then you make as much noise as you can. Use your horn. Beat the gorse. If the boar makes a run for it, we'll be waiting for him." The hunter tilted his head to the side doubtfully, but nodded.
"As the prefect commands."
There was something in his tone that struck Cato as being slightly off, a hint of obsequiousness that was uncharacteristic, and he feared that he had offended the man with the brusqueness of his order. Sometimes it was hard to take the soldier out of the man, he mused regretfully.
"Let's get moving," said Macro,
lifting his spear and holding the shaft out to the side.
"Before he gets the frights and bolts."
He urged his mount into a trot and rode off around the line of gorse. Cato handed the reins of the hunter's horse to Pernicatus with a nod and cantered off after his friend. As he had anticipated, the thicket was not large, and there was a clear gap between the far side and the pine trees. They found the place where the trail left the thicket easily enough, but leaning from his saddle, Cato saw no sign of blood. "He's still in there." The two Romans scanned the tangled undergrowth for movement or sound that might indicate the presence of the boar, but there was nothing. Cato readied his spear, and Macro followed suit. Then they took up position each side of the trail. "Ready?" asked Cato. Macro nodded.
"Pernicatus!" Cato called out. "Begin!"
The strident note of the hunter's horn cut through the cold air. The sound startled some birds, who burst from cover with a shrill chorus of panicked tweets, wings moving furiously as they fled towards the pine trees and disappeared. After a few more blasts of the horn, the hunter began to shout, and Cato could make out the faint crackle and snap of twigs breaking as they were beaten on the far side. Then they heard it, the snort and throaty squeal from somewhere between themselves and Pernicatus. A moment later, there was the rustle of dry vegetation as the boar drove towards them, charging down the trail.
"Here he comes!"
Macro shouted, his eyes wide with excitement, as he lowered the broad iron blade of his spear and held the shaft poised to strike. Cato did the same, keeping a firm grip of his reins and clenching his thighs against the saddle. The boar burst out of the thicket, and both men spurred forward. It was a huge, shaggy beast, with a darker line of bristles growing along its spine towards its large head, where curved tusks protruded either side of the snout. Macro was faster to react, and he leaned forward and lunged, the point of his spear driving into the boar's flank. The beast's jaws parted as it uttered a pained cry, then it swerved away from the spearhead, in towards Macro's mount, and collided with the pony's hind legs. Macro swayed, forced to drop his spear as he snatched at the saddle horns and held on tight to avoid being thrown off. His pony staggered in between the enraged boar and Cato, blocking the target for his friend. "Shit!" Cato hissed through gritted teeth as he pulled hard on the reins and tried to work his own mount round to strike at the beast.
Before he could get a clear sight, however, the boar turned and rushed back into the gorse, tearing along the narrow trail in the direction of Pernicatus. At once Cato grasped the danger facing the other man and quickly turned to Macro. "Get your spear and follow me!" Without waiting for a reply, he urged his pony into a gallop along the edge of the thicket, the blood pounding in his ears. There was always a risk in hunting, particularly with prey as deadly as wild boar, and that was why only the most reckless faced such a beast alone. As he steered his mount around the spiky tangles of gorse, he heard Pernicatus cry out in alarm. "He's here!" Swerving round an outlying clump of bushes, Cato caught sight of the hunter 100 paces away. He was on foot and facing the boar, a dagger in his hand. The beast, flanks heaving with exertion and surrounded by swirls of exhaled breath, stood between Pernicatus and his mount. As Cato kicked his heels in to force his pony to increase its pace, he saw the boar charge, kicking up gouts of snow as it sped towards Pernicatus. The hunter's pony reared in panic and turned to flee. Pernicatus lowered himself into a crouch and held his position until the last instant before throwing himself aside and slashing at the boar as it swept past. Despite its bulk, some 5 feet in length and as high as a man's midriff, the beast was nimble, and it slithered to a halt and swerved round in a heartbeat, ready to charge again. Cato tightened his grip on the shaft of his spear, but as he raced towards the confrontation, his mount stumbled. The sky and the frozen landscape spun around him as man and horse tumbled into the snow. The impact drove the breath from his lungs, and he released his grip on the spear and rolled aside to get clear. As he came up onto his feet, gasping for air, he saw that Pernicatus had released his dagger and somehow grasped the boar's tusks and was desperately trying to keep himself from being impaled as he wrestled with the beast. But it was an unequal struggle, and the hunter was battered and tossed as the boar hurled its weight around and tried to dislodge him. Cato glanced round in the calf-deep snow, but could not see his spear. His ears were filled with the ragged snorts of Macro's pony as the centurion rushed past him, braced firmly in his saddle as he leaned forward, right arm bunched up in readiness to thrust. The boar made a frenzied, twisting leap and tossed Pernicatus aside. The hunter flew through the air and landed heavily several feet away. Swinging its head from side to side, the beast turned and caught sight of its prey again and surged forward, tusks lowered, as Pernicatus scrambled away through the snow on hands and knees.
"No, you bloody don't!" Macro roared.
The shout and the blur of movement on the periphery of its vision caused the boar to hesitate and half turn towards the new threat, exposing its flank. Macro leaned out, tugging the reins to avoid a collision, and slammed the broad point of his spear into the animal's shoulder. The force of the impact drove the boar off its feet, and it landed on its side, twisting the shaft from Macro's grip so that it swayed from side to side above the beast's body as it writhed, bright flecks of blood spraying across the snow. Macro swung his leg across the saddle horn and dropped to the ground, then sprang forward and grasped the shaft in both hands, using his weight to pin the boar down as it snorted and squealed desperately. Pernicatus had retrieved his dagger and darted in to slash at the animal's throat. Cato, back on his feet, spotted his own spear and snatched it up before rushing to help his friends complete the kill. It was over before he reached the scene. With the last flailing of its trotters and a violent spasm, the boar slumped to the ground in defeat, blood pulsing from its wounds. After a final few pants, it stopped breathing and lay limply in the gore-streaked snow. For a moment longer, Macro continued to grip the spear shaft, leaning his weight on the weapon to keep the body pinned down. Pernicatus stood to one side, blood dripping from the tip of his dagger. Cato drew up and regarded them both anxiously until he saw that they appeared to be uninjured. All three were breathing hard. At last Macro eased up, twisting the shaft from side to side as he pulled it free. He shook his head.
"Fuck me. That was close."
Then he gulped a breath and laughed in nervous relief. His companions instinctively joined in before stepping back to regard their kill.
"He's a big brute," said Cato.
"Biggest I've seen." He glanced at the hunter. "Lucky escape." Pernicatus thought a moment before stepping towards Macro and extending his arm.
"You saved me, Centurion."
They clasped forearms,
and Macro puffed his cheeks.
I was lucky, friend. I'll be later and...
He drew a finger across his throat. The hunter grimaced and stared at him fixedly for a moment before bowing his head.
I owe you my life. Right place, right time, that's all.
Macro grinned.
Could have happened to any one of us.
Cato saw the pained look that flitted across the hunter's face. He realised that there was more weight to his words than Macro realised. A debt was owed, and Pernicatus regarded the matter with utmost seriousness. The man leaned over the boar's head and cut into the gristle around the snout, sawing and pulling at the tusks. When he had cut both free, he held them up for Macro.
These are yours. Your kill. Your prize.
When Macro hesitated, he wiped his dagger clean on the side of the carcass and sheathed his blade, before reaching into his tunic and drawing out a thick leather cord, from which several tusks hung.
Bring you good fortune, Centurion.
Cato wondered about that, given the hunter's close escape from death a moment ago.
Well, thanks.
Macro smiled diplomatically, which was no small achievement for him. No doubt being the senior magistrate of the colony had enhanced that side of his character, Cato thought. Once the tusks had been tucked away in Macro's side bag, the three men set about the business of butchering the carcass. The boar was too large to sling across the back of a pony and would need to be cut up into more manageable chunks. Fortunately, the hunter and the two soldiers were familiar with the messy task and set to it efficiently. Macro had made the killing blow, so was given two of the haunches, while Cato and Pernicatus had one apiece. With the meat loaded across the saddles, they cleaned the worst of the blood and fat from their hands by rubbing them in the snow. Then they retrieved their spears, took up the reins of their ponies, and turned back towards the colony on foot. It had taken over an hour to render the carcass, and labouring through the snow made for slow progress, so it was not until late in the afternoon that they crested the low ridge that overlooked Camelodunum, some mile and a half away, lying under a thin haze of wood smoke. The sprawl of buildings, a mixture of repurposed military structures, civilian dwellings with shingled roofs and thatched huts, surrounded the centre of the settlement, where the temple, theatre and other civic edifices were in the process of construction. The walls of the sacred precinct had already been erected, as well as the stepped pediment and the first few feet of the enclosure. The round bases of the columns were in place, and stonemasons had cut the fluted sections that would be raised into position once a crane had been set up.
"The temple's going to be quite a sight when it's finished,"
said Macro with a hint of pride.
"Hope I live long enough to see it."
He glanced at Pernicatus and grinned.
"You're young. You'll be sure to see it. I envy you."
"Envy?"
the hunter said.
"Aye. Who wouldn't want to see such a fine building rising above the surrounding countryside?"
Macro continued.
"A tribute to Roman engineering and civilization. It'll still be standing long after the rest of those buildings and huts have gone."
Cato sensed the hunter's discomfort at Macro's words, and he could understand the cause. The cost of the temple and the rest of the public buildings was falling mostly on the shoulders of the Trinovantes. Their taxes had been increased by Macro's predecessor as senior magistrate. A poisonous bequest indeed, thought Cato. The resentment of the natives towards their Roman overlords was apparent enough, and the recent poor harvest had made the tax burden more onerous still. Human nature being what it was, most of the Trinovantes blamed the current incumbent, Macro, regardless of the fact that their suffering was nothing to do with him. No doubt Pernicatus shared the feelings of his people, even as he seemed to enjoy the company of the two Roman officers, and appreciated the silver they paid him to act as their guide. Now that Macro had saved his life, a further obligation weighed on him. Cato tried to change the subject.
"I'm hungry. I can already taste roast boar."
He smiled at the others.
"And we've enough here to feed us until Saturnalia."
"More than enough,"
Macro grinned, as they began to descend the slope towards the colony. Away to the east, nearly 2 miles from the far side of Camelodunum,
Cato spied a distant column approaching along the track that led towards the lands of the Iceni. There were 20 or so riders, 2 wagons drawn by horses and several figures on foot at the rear. Too many men for a merchant, and too few to constitute any danger to those in the colony. Nonetheless, his curiosity was piqued, and he pointed them out to Macro.
Could be a military detachment. There's an outpost on the border with the Iceni. They might be coming for supplies. We'll know soon enough. If they're here for long, they could join in the celebrations. The gods only know we could use some diversion from the endless bloody cold of the winter in this province.
Halfway between the ridge and the colony, a track branched off to a small group of huts where Pernicatus and his extended family lived. Once, the land around them had been their farm, but now it had been appropriated by a retired Roman officer, one of the centurions, who had taken it as part of his retirement bonus. Pernicatus and his folk still worked the land, only now they did so in exchange for a fraction of the produce they grew, and the owner sold the rest to grain merchants in Londinium. This was one of the reasons the hunter was obliged to offer his services to Roman officers. The coins he was paid allowed him to buy back some of the grain to support his people through the harsh winter. The three of them halted at the junction, and Cato took out his purse and counted out the coins to meet the fee they had agreed. Pernicatus took them with a nod of thanks and slipped them into his side bag. "One other thing," said Cato, as he lifted his boar haunch off the back of his pony and offered it to Pernicatus. "As Macro said, we have more than enough for our needs. Here, take it." The Trinovantian hesitated. Like all those who had once been warriors in his tribe, he was a proud man and found it hard to accept charity from a Roman. "You've earned it," said Cato. "We'd never have been able to track the beast down without you."
"As the prefect wishes," the hunter responded.
He accepted the meat and secured it over his saddle so that one haunch hung from each side. Then he tapped 2 fingers against his forehead in the manner of the Britons and turned to lead his mount down the track towards the huts.
"We'll hunt again after Saturnalia,"
Cato called after him. Pernicatus waved his spear in acknowledgement, but didn't look back. Macro whistled softly.
"There's gratitude for you. Why did you give him that? It was most of your share."
"I've got plenty left. Claudia and I aren't going to go hungry, unlike some of the locals."
"So that's it."
Macro shook his head.
"You can't afford to show pity to everyone you meet, lad."
"It's not pity. It's respect. These lands once belonged to his people, for generations beyond memory."
"And now it belongs to Rome, by right of conquest. You think the Trinovantes didn't take it off someone else at some point? Do you think if the positions were reversed, he'd have given you his share of the meat?"
"He might." Macro led his horse back down the main track.
"Sometimes I really don't understand you, Cato. You've been a soldier, what, some 17 years now? You're the reason Rome has an empire. It's us soldiers who won it for Rome. We fought for it, shed blood for it, and now we get to enjoy our spoils."
"That's true," Cato responded, following his friend. "But it's not about that for me. It's about the men I serve with. They've been my family all my adult life. It's them I fight for." Macro nodded.
"I know that. I understand. And you're right. That's why I miss it. I'm happy enough with me lot. I've got a fine woman, a good home, and top seat at the colony senate. But so help me, I miss the army. It's a shame that it's all over for me now. No more fighting. But at least there's hunting to be done. Jupiter's bollocks, that boar was a monster. For a moment there, I thought you had the three of us banged to rights."
Cato smiled. He was glad for Macro that he had found his place in Camelodunum, where he could live out his days with Petronella in peace. Many soldiers did not survive to see such times. If death did not claim them at the hands of the enemy, then injury or sickness usually did. It was Macro's dogged toughness, and not a little good fortune, that had seen him reach this point. Cato was still on the active list, and would likely be recalled and given a fresh command someday. He hoped Fortuna would be as kind to him as she had been to Macro, and that he too would live out his retirement with Claudia at his side. By then, Lucius would have reached manhood, and Cato wondered what the future had in store for his son. He would have more opportunities than Cato himself had enjoyed. Even though he had risen to the equestrian class of Roman society, that would be as far as he was likely to advance by virtue of his humble origins. Lucius would start from a higher base, and might one day aspire to become a senator, maybe even a consul. The prospect thrilled Cato. To have come so far in two generations. At the same time, there was a niggling frustration about the limit placed on his own ability and ambition. The best he could hope for was to become the imperial prefect of Aegyptus. The province was the main supplier of grain to Rome, and as such was ruled by a man directly appointed by the emperor, lowly enough in rank not to use the position to challenge him. Meanwhile, he would have to endure the prospect of watching lesser men secure senior political and military appointments for no better reason than the accident of birth that accorded them greater opportunities to win power and wealth than were afforded to the son of a slave. At least Lucius would be able to do the things he himself was denied, Cato comforted himself. They walked on in happy anticipation of returning home. The watchman on the colony gate raised a hand in greeting as they approached. Even though the gatehouse was almost all that remained of the original defences of the fortress, there were certain niceties to be observed. People came and went from the colony through the gates, just as they would at any other Roman settlement surrounded by a ditch and a wall.
"Good hunting, Centurion!" he called out.
Macro stood aside to reveal the meat hanging over his saddle.
"As good as it gets, friend. Boars don't come much bigger on this island.
Only in Sardinia, sir."
"Bollocks."
"It's true," said Cato. "I've seen them. Some of them are monsters."
"Bah!"
Macro made a dismissive gesture as he passed between the posts and entered the colony. Cato shared a glance with the watchman, and both men rolled their eyes. Dusk was gathering over Camalodunum, and the smells of the evening meals that were being prepared filled the cold air, sharpening the appetite of the two officers as they made their way along the main street to Macro's house in the centre of the settlement. Coming the other way, they saw the group of travellers they had spotted earlier. They could see now that they were mounted warriors, large men in thick cloaks with long Celtic swords worn at their sides and shields hanging from their saddles. Behind them rumbled the wagons, crude vehicles with solid wooden wheels. Near the head of the mounted party, a woman rode alone with the hood of her emerald cloak drawn over her head. An imposing figure, sitting tall in the saddle even after a day's travel, when some of her escort were slumped forward wearily. She called out a curt word of command as she drew level with the entrance to Macro's house, and the party came to a halt. As Macro's stable hand emerged from the covered gateway, she addressed him in fluent Latin.
"Boy, fetch your master and tell the magistrate that we need shelter for the night."
Macro drew up and waited for Cato to come alongside him.
"Bloody hell. You know who that is?"
"Unmistakable," said Cato. "Boudica, Queen of the Iceni." Chapter 3. Although the daylight hours were short, the inhabitants of the colony made the most of them as they celebrated Saturnalia at the close of the year. Bright strips of cloth and boughs of holly were hung above the doors and windows of the dwellings, and the air was rich with the aroma of cooking as neighbours vied to outdo each other. The festivities began at dawn with the sacrifice of a lamb on the altar at the unfinished temple. The colony's priest, assigned to the imperial cult, pronounced that the entrails were propitious, and that the gods were pleased with the offering and had blessed the day's celebrations. A schedule of races, wrestling bouts, and a display of gladiatorial combat was provided by a travelling lanista for a modest fee, which was all the small colony could afford. Consequently, the three pairs of gladiators who faced each other in the turf arena outside the settlement were well past their prime. The veterans jeered and laughed as clumsy blows were traded, and since the fee only covered fighting to the first blood, there was little drama in the display. The only serious wound arose when Aretiarius lost his grip on his trident and managed to skewer his own foot. The crowd sitting on the raked rows of simple wooden benches roared with laughter as his opponent punched the air to claim victory, while the Lannister hurried forward with a small medical chest to treat the injury. In the afternoon, under a clear sky, the feasting began. People moved from home to home to honour the small shrines of the household spirits before sampling the food and wine laid out for them. Mindful of the evening feast still to come, most of the adults ate and drank sparingly, but the children gorged themselves, shouting excitedly as they chased each other through the muddy streets. As the light faded, the inhabitants drifted back to their homes for the final stage of the celebrations. In the hall of Macro's home, two rough-hewn tables had been set up, with benches and stools beside them. He had not bought any slaves yet, so it was the servants and guests who would be treated as masters of the household that evening, according to custom. Parvus, the two Iceni serving girls and the stable hand, were joined by Boudica, her daughters and her bodyguards, nearly 30 souls in all. It was the first time that Macro had met the Queen's children, and he was struck by the difference between the two girls. The younger, Merida, was tall and blonde like her father had been, while the older, Bardia, was shorter and sturdier, with dark hair and features. Macro and Petronella had been roasting the boar over a charcoal fire since midday, and the rich scent of the slow-cooked meat coming from the kitchen block was mouth-watering. As the last of the daylight faded, Cato, Claudia and Lucius arrived with the dog, bearing baskets of bread and honeyed pastries. Cato was pulling a small handcart containing two jars of wine packed in straw to protect them from the jolts of the rutted street. Cassius's nose lifted to savour the aroma of the roasting boar, and he padded cautiously towards the counter where Petronella was cutting the cooked meat into manageable portions.
"Shoo!" she glared at him. "You'll have some scraps later if you're good."
Cassius backed off and then craned his neck to one side to keep the meat in view. Lucius set down his basket of bread with an exaggerated sigh.
"Can I go and join Parvus, father?"
Cato shook his head. "You know you can't. Tonight you must serve Parvus and the others, just like the rest of us." Lucius frowned.
"I don't want to." "It's only one night of the year."
Claudia smiled encouragingly.
"It won't harm you." "But I don't want to,"
Lucius repeated haughtily.
"They're our servants. They're there to do what we tell them. I don't care about Saturnalia."
Cato placed the basket on a shelf above the reach of Cassius and squatted in front of his son so their faces were on the same level. "Listen, there's a good reason for Saturnalia. It reminds us that whatever our place in the world now, it could change at any time, for any reason. Take me. I am the son of a slave. Now I own slaves at our house in Rome. For that I thank Fortuna. And Saturnalia reminds me of how much I have to be grateful for. It reminds me that but for a twist of fate, I might be a slave or a servant, and those who serve us might be my masters. So tonight, you will wait on Parvus and count your blessings, my boy."
"I still don't like it."
Cato stared at him a moment before he spoke again. "You want to be a soldier when you grow up, don't you?"
"Yes."
"You want to be an officer? You want to lead men?"
"Yes, father."
Lucius lifted his chin imperiously. "Then you need to learn what Uncle Macro and I have known ever since we were given men to command. A good leader looks after his horses and mules before his men, and his men before himself. He feeds his soldiers first before he looks to his own hunger. If you don't understand that, Lucius, then you will never be a good leader. Do you understand?" The boy's gaze fell to the floor, and Cato gently lifted his chin so he could not avoid his gaze. "Do you understand, Lucius?"
I suppose so."
"Good man." Cato stood up again and gestured to the Samianware bowls on the counter beside Petronella. "Now, why don't you take a plate of meat and some bread to Parvus to get the feast started? Show him how a good leader looks after his men, eh?" Lucius nodded, stiffened his spine and heaped a generous portion of meat into the bowl, along with a ladle of fried onions and two small loaves. Then he left the kitchen and made for the hall.
"He's a good boy,"
said Claudia, as she kissed Cato on the cheek.
"He'll make you proud one day."
"He already does." Macro looked up from the spit he was still turning.
"You two gonna help us or just play lovestruck like a couple from a cheap theatrical romance?"
The role reversal was regarded with bewilderment by those of Boudicca's bodyguard, who were not familiar with the Roman custom. At length, the servants and the guests had been fully sated, and Macro and the others helped themselves to what remained of the food and took their places at the bottom of one of the tables, next to Boudicca and some of her men.
"I hope you've had enough to eat," said Petronella.
The Iceni queen had barely cleared half her bowl and looked tired and strained. She tried to smile.
"You have done us proud. A true Roman feast." "Oh, this is nothing like the feasts back in Rome," Claudia intervened. "But it's as good as it can get here in a frontier on the edge of the empire."
She nodded at Petronella.
"You've done wonders with what is available. I've never enjoyed such succulent meat from a boar."
Boudicca turned to Macro and Cato.
"I have to say, your Saturnalia is an odd custom."
"You've nothing like it amongst the Iceni?"
asked Macro.
"No. We have a warrior caste, and the rest are farmers and some slaves. It is their duty to provide for the warriors, as well as themselves. Everyone knows their place and what is expected of them. The Iceni would never play such games as you do."
"I see. A pity." Cato indicated the burly men of her bodyguard sitting nearby. "But what place is there for warriors in your tribe, now that the Iceni and Rome are at peace?"
"Peace."
Boudicca repeated the word with a look of distaste, as if she had just eaten something horribly sour.
"We agreed an alliance with Rome. We have honoured our side of the treaty. My fear is that your emperor may not do the same when we present Prosuticus's will to the governor in Londinium. I've learned that some of Rome's emperors have a habit of promising one thing and doing another. When we swear an oath of loyalty, along with the other tribes at the ceremony to mark the new year, I hope that will be enough to satisfy him."
"I hope so too," Cato responded.
"And if it isn't?"
Boudicca regarded him closely.
"What do you think he will do?"
There was an awkward pause as Cato struggled to frame a response in diplomatic terms. "It all depends on how the governor interprets the situation. But whatever he does, the matter will have to be referred to the emperor for the ultimate decision."
"So I understand. And what do you think Nero will decide?"
Cato hesitated again, and this time she leaned closer and touched his arm.
"For the sake of the friendship we have, and for the times we have fought side by side, be honest with me."
"There are rumours, more than rumours, that Nero and some of his closest advisers are considering abandoning Britannia. I'm not so sure I agree. It would look like a defeat, however it is presented. But a rumour is often enough to make people act. I know that a number of tribes in Britannia have been loaned money by powerful men in Rome. They will want to call in the loans if there is any question of the new province being abandoned. The emperor will give orders for his soldiers and officials to loot the island of as much portable wealth as possible before they withdraw. If Nero does decide to keep the province within the empire, he will be under pressure to make it pay its way. His officials will find any and every means they can to raise taxes and appropriate land and wealth. Against such a background, I fear for the future of you and your people. The death of Prosuticus may be the pretext needed to annex the land of the Iceni and confiscate its wealth. I pray that I am wrong, and that the will is honoured, and Rome continues to treat you like a loyal ally. With all my heart." Boudicca eased herself away with a sad, worn expression.
"If it comes to that, how do you imagine my people and I will react?"
"In your place, I know how I'd react," Macro intervened. "I'd fight it. What else would anyone with a sense of honour do if they were treated like that? But it would be foolish. There can only be one outcome. For all their bravery, the Iceni cannot hope to defeat the legions. They'd be crushed and would lose everything along with their lives. Those spared would be sold into slavery. In 10 or 20 years, no one would remember they ever existed.
Cato mentally winced at his friend's frank appraisal. The Iceni queen sighed.
So, the choice is submission or death.
If that is what is presented to my people, then regardless of the outcome, they will choose to fight. And I will choose to lead them in that fight. There is no question of abject submission for the Iceni. Our pride, our traditions, our honour will not tolerate it.
You speak as the queen. You speak for the nobles and your warriors. But do you speak for the common people of your tribe?
I think not. Do you imagine their day-to-day lives will change much if Rome annexes your lands and sweeps away your nobility? All the ordinary people care about is putting enough food into their stomachs to survive. In the end, what difference does it make if they are ruled by you and your nobles or Rome?
I think I know my people better than you, Cato. They are the Iceni.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.